my whole strategy career wise, the whole thing was just to make the best painting I can, you know. That's it. That's my whole career, you know, business. That's my whole business strategy is to make as good a work painting as I can, to become a really good painter, to make hopefully paintings that are so good that they have to be successful, you know, or I have to, you know, and people will want them and want to work and so forth. And so, you know, I don't, where I fail, you know, I feel like that's, I haven't done that, you know.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another exciting episode of Artists Decoded. This episode is sponsored by No Wave. The No Wave Art Collective is now offering limited edition artist-proof t-shirts. The first run is available till November 19th with only 100 editions printed of each shirt. Artists Decoded is offering a 10% discount at checkout. Go to nohwave.bigcartel.com to purchase these t-shirts. Type in Artists Decoded, one word with all caps at checkout to receive your 10% off. So welcome to the podcast. This is episode number 86 with painter and artist Colin Chillag, accompanied by his wife, writer, journalist, and professor Jenna Duncan. I personally got a lot out of this conversation, and before going into this conversation, I really wanted to explore Colin's process with him. Not so much from a technical standpoint, but more so from a philosophical standpoint. And before going into this conversation, I recognized something fascinating about Colin's work, and I saw this creative honesty and integrity in his work that attracted me to his artwork. I also sensed this curious sense of, I guess, self-exploration within his work too. There's also a unique personality and humor to his work, and I find it hard to eloquently juxtapose seemingly humorous and serious subjects and mash them together into a beautifully and purposefully constructed piece. I was very excited to have this conversation with Colin for all of those varying reasons, and we talked about his seemingly unfinished cityscapes and his technically deconstructed figurative paintings. We also got into a discussion on meditation and how it's helped him with his work. Just keep in mind, this episode talks a lot about certain reoccurring characteristics within his body of work. If you want to go check out his artwork, it'll be on our website, artistsdecoded.com, or on his Instagram at Colin Chillag. Also, if you want to follow me on social media, my social media handle is at Yoshino Studios. So here it is, without further ado, episode 86 with painter Colin Chillag.
I went to the San Francisco Art Institute right after high school. I grew up in Phoenix, Arizona. Then went to SFAI 89, but I'd been painting for a few years, you know, all through high school and kind of leading up to that, and decided I wanted to be a painter pretty early on. So, but that was a weird place to be. They had just started an undergraduate program. It had previously been only exclusively a graduate school. So There was, I think they were still adjusting, and I don't remember getting a whole lot of, instruction, at least that stuck with me, but it was still an interesting place to be because you were exposed to a lot of different ways of working, obviously. And a lot of that, and the Bay Area is just a really interesting and vibrant place, with, an interesting artistic history to it.
Are you originally from the Bay Area?
No, born in Syracuse, New York, and then the family sort of moved west. Ended up with my mother and my brother in Phoenix.
From
like five on. So I grew up there, basically.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. So you lived in Phoenix, and then you went to San Francisco, and then you went back to Phoenix.
Yeah. Right?
There's a few
deviations, but I stayed in
Northern California for a while, right? And then you did a stint in Seattle.
Yeah, I was on the Northwest for about 10 years, and then I moved back to Phoenix. I've been back in Phoenix for like 17 years. So,
oh wow,
yeah, this is all over about a 30-year period.
Yeah, so. How has that transformed your artwork moving back to Phoenix, a place that you grew up essentially for a majority of your formative years, and then kind of having a different lens on that? You know, because essentially you went to college to San Francisco in the Bay Area and kind of was up there in the West.
Well, I'm sure I brought some skills back with me, but, you know, you have that, it's just in that desert environment growing up, so you're sort of imbued with a certain, I don't know, understanding and familiarity with it.
Yeah.
And so I guess you kind of revisit that. I mean, that subject matter recurs in my work. Often not I directly focus on it. Sometimes I do. Like regional subject matter that's particular to that area.
You have more of an appreciation for the desert than a lot of people I know.
Yeah, I guess it.
An interest.
Yeah, it's just, yeah, it's sometimes I guess I don't even notice it. It's just my work's imbued with the soul of the place in some way, you know. You often see this in artists wherever, you know, whoever, you know, like Dali always returned to this, I think it's like a Catalan landscape, you know, in his work. And I always felt like, you know, that's sort of similar. I mean, in a similar way, I do the same thing, you know.
Yeah, there's something interesting about your work, because when I look at it and I think of the subjects that you choose to paint, maybe as of the past like 7 years. So I have a question about that, but I also have a question about this documentation of like the seemingly like mundane almost, or this like,
I don't know, man. I mean, this might be a good time to mention the meditation practice that we were talking a little bit about that before we started recording. But I had a meditation practice about 8 years ago I started, and you know, as you know, that's all about just focusing on the present moment and, you know, really paying attention. And that somehow, it wasn't a real conscious thing, but that transferred, I think, into my work. And so things got, see, there's a lot to this. It gets sort of complicated. My early work was characterized by, I think, just of more of a plurality of ways of working. You know, I think it was all very much, you know, a manifestation of typical of postmodernism, you know, and that one way of working is not necessarily any better than another way of working. And so it was all about a plurality of styles and approaches to painting, and then mixing and matching them, and often very disparate ways of working and mashing them together in one way or another.
So do you think it was more about technical approaches and then kind of finding?
Well, some of it was personal, like, I guess the later work, you know, personal experience, things that were familiar. I always liked that approach. You know, I remember even seeing like a comic book, Dan Clowes, when I was in art school, and he did a comic book, I think it was called Art School Confidential or something. And it was, it blew me away that someone could take something so close to their life, or that my life, you know, that I experienced every day, you know, and funny things about your interactions with people and, you know, in that, and make art out of that, you know, something that close to your normal, even though going to art school perhaps isn't the most normal experience, but it's, you know, it was my everyday experience. And there, here was somebody, you know, making a, you know, comic book, making art out of that experience. And that, and so, so that, that became, you know, a really, that way of working became a distinct possibility in my mind and started to come into my work in my own way. And I loved that. I loved when I could find a way to reference normal, everyday, some, you know, banal, mundane types of experiences, you know, and make them make them relevant and interesting and maybe even beautiful, you know.
Is that why you paint Circle K's?
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of in keeping with that whole way of approaching art.
You yeah, know? I think, yeah, it's interesting looking at your cityscapes or like the Circle K's, for instance, just looking at that and then thinking about the reasons why, and, you know, obviously I'm just a viewer looking from the outside, but I'm thinking like, you know, what are the reasons why you would paint this Circle K, and then you'd also do it in a way that is like unfinished too. But then I was thinking about it more in like a philosophical sense. Like, first of all, you only intake like a certain amount of information at every single time. And another thing, it's like about the process, and you are trying to show people the process. You know, you're kind of like the magician showing someone how you do the trick, essentially. But also, I think of moments, and then these moments that are like essentially unfinished in a way, you know, because, and we're just trying to grasp and understand like the moment, you know, and then looking back on the moment. And these are all things, you know, it's like, it's the artist's approach, right? But then it's also the viewer's take on the artist's approach. So that's, I guess that's my, that was my, what I was thinking when I was looking at your work.
Yeah. No, it's a good observations, because I've thought about them in all those same ways, you know, mm-hmm. approximately from perception, you know, that this, it felt somehow, some of that unfinished quality felt, mm-hmm. it had a realness to me just in relation to the way we perceive the world, you know. I mean, we might be conscious and aware and focused on, you know, just a tiny percentage of even what's in our field of vision, you know, that kind of thing, even though we have a broader perception. So it's kind of like focusing on something. It's like, you know, again, like meditation in a way, you know, you're training your consciousness on a particular experience, you know.
When I first met him and became familiar with his work, that point kind of frustrated me.
What like, point?
I can remember looking at this beautiful painting that Colin did, and it was of our friend Abby hiking at the Grand Canyon, and the portrait is unfinished intentionally. And for me, that was very frustrating, because I wanted to have the whole canvas filled in, I guess, because that's what I'm used to. And then I felt kind of disappointed in myself for feeling that frustration, because it seems too obvious. But it really was like, what's this guy trying to do? And it made me think about it and go away and still feel frustrated, mm-hmm. which I guess is an effective device, because you made me keep thinking about it.
Is it funny how that in the relationship sense too, it's like you always want to stay curious about the other person?
Yeah, you know, but I was like, what is this guy trying to do? I just mm-hmm. can't get my mind around that or answer that very easily. And I might be kind of type A. That might be my problem. I might be kind of OCD and I need things to be finished. Mm-hmm. Like I'm the oldest child, and I have a sense of order, and I like things done the right way.
Uh-huh. That's probably how you balance each other out.
Yeah.
Probably. Right? Possibly. Very possibly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think there's definitely some opposite aspects to our personality.
Yeah.
I benefit from.
Yeah. You're like, I can only speak for myself.
Because I stay on top of things, like the bills. Yeah. But this question has come up with other people. Like he gave a talk at BYU in March, and one of the student artists that was in it was like an auditorium, mm-hmm. asked that same question. It was like, why is the canvas unfinished? And I don't think there really is an easy way to answer why. Or like you said, maybe it's for the viewer to have your own interpretation, which I appreciate. Yeah.
I guess that's what I'm trying to get across too. It's like, the complexity of your work and the diversity of your work, it seems more of like a natural approach instead of you essentially finding something that worked and you could sell it commercially, and you're just regurgitating that process over and over and over and beating it with a dead horse. You know, it seems like there are these facets to the way that you've worked in the past, and you're continuing to like explore those. And that's what I found really interesting about your work.
Thank you. It's nice to get a compliment like that with someone who gets it, you know. I mean, appreciates that.
Because it has been a challenge to find a way to... I mean, the commercial aspect has been a challenge.
It's been okay, but...
Sorry to chime in, but...
The commercial aspect is definitely a challenge.
Well, it's very
ongoing one.
Yeah, it's of course it's it's very challenging, especially because it's like.
But it is for every artist. I mean, some some hit on you know something that works, and then they stick to it, and like you're talking about, and I can't blame them for that. You know, you know, it's, if they're making it work.
What are the challenges that you've encountered
artistically? I was talking a little bit about the early work and how it was about mixing and matching different ways of working, and it would often get out of control. And I mean, you talk about not having consistency or, you know, a marketable product, you know, that was my, that plagued me for, well, my whole career really, you know, but a lot of that is just discipline, and more concerted effort at, well, I have to say no to a lot of ideas, you know, which is the hard thing. So it you know, and just stick to one way of working. You know, there are pros and cons to all of this, but you know, there was so much of this sort of jumping around from one way of working to another that it became too much. And this is where the the meditation practice kind of comes in again. You know, as it helped me sort of. Focus and, you know, in some ways be more disciplined and pay attention to everyday experiences and incorporate them, I guess, into my practice, a little more. And it all became, and it, you know, I have to make certain conscious choice about, you know, ways of working. Like, I mean, and that's when I really, I think became primarily a realist painter. You know, there's still, again, deviations from that here and there, but for the most part, that's what it's centered around. And I like that because, you know, again, I'm probably going to keep referencing the meditation practice, but to me, that felt perfect for that time and still to this day, because it's, you know, it's this attempt to, you know, just pay attention and find meaning and interest in everyday normal experiences, you know, which I think is the conceptual basis of realism. You know, that is, the world is interesting enough and meaningful enough if you pay attention to it. You know, you don't need to embellish it with fantastical meanings, or in terms of painting, fantastical, you know, forms or exaggerations. So that was always the challenge of realism for me, was to, you know, paint something straightforward and with a high degree of focus and observation, but not have it be boring, you know.
Yeah,
have it be interesting. And
but that's why I like your work too, is because there is that sense of realism, but yet, I mean, there's even that painting where it says like "fuck you, Dave" on it, and then I feel like that's more of, and I could be wrong, but I feel like that's more of you, kind of maybe like it's a more punk rock approach of you saying like "fuck you," like I don't want to do this hyper realistic thing, and I just want to, you know, I mean, I could be wrong, you know.
No, I think that's Colin showing you some of his own personality and sense of humor often. Because, and that's what makes each painting, a lot of the realistic ones, even more personal. Because if you look at the marginalia, a lot of it is real things from our lives. Like, he had a calendar on there. We were trying to do a juice cleanse or something. We were doing a cleanse. And he was keeping track day by day. And he's had other little notes, like a guy that he had to call. He put his real phone number on the painting. That's and awesome. I was like, you're going to sell this and somebody's going to try to call that number. And that's kind of funny. Former boss noticed
about a certain period when I was making, like I would do the realist painting and it would develop over a period of
I guess you don't do that month, all the time.
Keep, notes on the painting, you know, comments and, you know, often dealing with everyday experience, little reminders, notes to self and this sort of thing.
Right.
But so they develop while the painting was developing and,
yeah, but that's what I like. That's what I liked about it, because it's that idea of like perfectly imperfect. You have something that it just seems more personal. I like all kinds of different art forms, you know, like films and like, you know, the things that I feel like I like the most, aside from like the surreal sort of aspects of artwork, but it's more about like, it's more of a personal approach to it. You know, it doesn't have to be perfect. Nothing has to be like really perfect. It can be, I guess that's why I like your unfinished works and some of those things where it's like a perfectly painted piece, but then there you have this like, you know, like circle with it, with it's like a stick figure almost.
Mm-hmm. Or spray paint. Or yeah.
Spray paint.
Okay, so that's also a thing that has frustrated me from time to time. Because I love what he does and I don't want to question it. But once in a while, he'd have this beautiful painting and then he'd take it outside and he'd spray paint on it. And then, and somebody actually asked about that.
Well, the spray paint's perfect because I have no ability with a can of spray paint.
So it just looks sloppy, just like a disaster.
De-skilled.
I don't know how that's perfect.
I mean, it's like the most rudimentary level of skill. You know, I haven't attained that, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't get too close to it and far away.
But that's what I like about that. No, that's what I like about that. Because, okay, so I'll give another example. Like, one of my favorite contemporary painters is Nicolas Amori. And he does...
I know his work.
He does these perfect sort of, like, classical renditions of paintings, and then he'll burn it.
Cool.
Or he'll, like, it'll be on a panel, and he'll, like, get an axe to it.
Yeah.
And, but... I don't know. I guess that's just my approach too. It's kind of like, it doesn't matter like what medium you create it with, or, you know, it's, I guess that's why I like your artwork. Cause I can kind of see that in myself a little bit.
Yeah. And there's certainly there are a whole bunch of different ways of looking at that half finished aspect, but part of it is certainly a kind of frustration. Like what is the point in finishing this, you know, I mean,
yeah, it's very like existential.
It just ends up being another realist painting out there. You know, it might be, you know, a good one, but does the world need that? You know, is all that important? And anyway, I've done enough, so we'll just stop here. You know, all these sort of aspects play into that kind of half finished quality that a lot of the paintings have, but. But I'm trying to get away from that a little bit now, just because after a certain time, you know, you have something that had meaning when you started it, and a real reason or something you're doing in your work that you're really very interested in pursuing, and then it starts to transition into becoming a, you know, formulaic or, you know,
and
maybe even gimmicky at times, you know, that you're...
Well, you could take it too far and ruin it, or like.
So I'm just trying to. Most of my work now is, you know, painting from one edge to the other for the most part. You know, finishing the whole painting. But
what do you find interesting now in terms of creating new work?
I'm working a lot from found photographs now. I've done a little bit of that in the past. So I'm getting back to that, in particular, Polaroids from the 60s and 70s.
Yeah,
that kind of period.
Yeah,
I'll have to show you some stuff.
That's what's on view right now.
Yeah, it's mostly that's most of the recent stuff on my Instagram page. I mean, it's probably the best place to see the recent work.
And that's what's up in your show in Phoenix and at those pieces at 101.
But there's some. The ones I sent to the gallery here were all like homemade, you know, pornography.
Nudie.
Yeah, they're like
Polaroids.
You know, they're not super graphic.
Do you find those?
Yeah, I just find them online mostly.
Oh, okay.
But in the past, I worked. You know, I just have these boxes of Polaroids. I don't know how I found them. Sometimes people would send them to me, or I'd find them in thrift stores or something. And so that was the source material. And some of the recent work is from, you know, my own collection of Polaroids. But increasingly I'm finding them online. You know, there's so many images out there. A lot of them I'm just stealing from people.
You're a pirate.
Would you say that half of the subjects are people that you know, and then half are just people that you have never met?
All of the recent ones are strangers, but I have painted been my wife maybe five or six. And so that's not, yeah. So I like that idea. It's it's along the lines of painting what's familiar and close to you, you know?
Yeah.
So it's in keeping with that idea. But the honestly, the Polaroids don't feel all that much different. One reason I like those so much is, well, they tend to be like images that would come from anyone's family album, you know, so they feel very familiar to me, and they have the look of, you know, given my age, 46 now, they have the look and feel of my own childhood, you know, because of the period.
Yeah.
So I, you know, it's, there's a bit of nostalgia, you know, mixed into these paintings for sure.
But what made you want to paint some of the more pornographic images? Because I feel like there's that punk rock approach again, because then you have these family portraits and it's in a similar aesthetic to these pornographic portraits, but because of the subject matter, it's different.
He just likes getting kicked off of Facebook.
Yeah. I saw that. You put something that, oh yeah, well, that and Instagram. I saw that on Instagram. You said something about
Instagram's been cool to me lately, but Facebook.
Which is weird, because aren't they owned by Facebook?
Yeah. Oculus, Facebook, and Instagram are all the same company, or they're on the
Somebody's been busting him on Facebook. Like, somebody must have been actively complaining. And then I told him, how could this be a friend? You know, they friended you, and now they're going to, you post your work and they're going to report it.
They didn't friend me. I friended. They asked for my friendship.
They asked. Oh, that's even worse.
I granted it. And then they complained.
We don't know who it was complaining,
but
got taken down.
Yeah. Slam.
Again and again.
I got banned again for 7 days just the other day.
Did
that's
you?
That's how it works now.
Then I posted one and I put, I tried to.
I'm not on there that much anyway.
I tried to write this plea on the comments that was like, dear Instagram, please don't take down this beautiful painting. It's a painting.
Yeah.
And it got taken down anyway. So whatever.
That's what I've been doing on Instagram. If it's a, if it's kind of a pornographic image, and then I don't even think of that. When I research these, I go online and I look for nudie pics. I'm actually not,
I do quite selecting. A bit of research as well.
I'm just kidding.
Check anyone's history. Yeah. No.
I'm just messing with you. But yeah, go on. Sorry. You're saying?
I'm not selecting for the images that I find the most personally titillating. You know, there's often a kind of awkwardness and, an amateurish quality and awkwardness. Like they just, like something you would see in a family album. You're just leafing through someone's family album, but they decide to put images of their sex life in, you know, your mom's got some pics. It's like what it would look like if your mom had pictures along of, you know, with your baby pics, there was, you know, how you were conceived. And you know, which makes sense.
They seem very familiar and casual in a lot of ways. Not professional, that's for sure. So that's, I think, why he called it the girlfriend series. Because it just seems like something you'd carry around to remember your girlfriend.
Yeah.
Not a porn star, just, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, they're very amateurish looking images for sure. Yeah. You know, they have the shadow from the flash bulb and all that. Yeah.
I like that, though. I think it's funny. It definitely, you can feel a sense of your sense of humor in those, you know, the more, and I think the more that I was looking through your work, the more that I kind of understood more about your personality. And sometimes you can't see that in people's work. Sometimes people don't want to show you.
It's too clinical or something.
Yeah.
In another way, at the same time, I can see how some of those photos that he's looking at present interesting challenges for a painter. Was like, how am I going to approach this? Or how do I come up with this color? Or some of the Polaroids are going through the effects of deterioration. And so, you know, with a Polaroid, the chemicals just go bad. And so it fades and around the corners or just does interesting things. And then he's mimicking that in paint. I'm really impressed by that. Because instead of just trying to, you know, keep the real photographic, realistic image, he's got those bad chemicals in there and that kind of tells a story too, because it's like, this photo's aging. It's
for sure
deteriorating. It won't always be here.
Yeah, definitely influenced by some of those aging effects and or just, you know, bad overexposure or something, you know, that goes on in those photos.
Yeah. It's also interesting to think about photography as memories too, because it's always like we're trying to tangibly take something, a memory, and try to encapsulate it in like a photographic image. I mean, I'm a photographer, so it's like I've almost made it like a profession out of it. Yet memories are fleeting as well, you know, but for some reason, psychologically, we want to be able to hold on to those.
Yeah. Photography is amazing. I mean, it just, and to think it didn't exist, you know, more than, you know, whatever, 100, 120, 40 years ago.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, just all throughout human.
Instagram didn't exist 15 years
and
ago.
We're just, yeah.
But, wow.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But, you know, our entire lives, it's been there as a source of, you know, seeing what things look like in the past, you know, which, you know, is always, whenever you think about it, just so strange that you can see an image from the past, you know. Mm-hmm.
Have you ever seen Black Mirror?
No.
It's a series. I mean, you can see it on Netflix. I don't think it's a Netflix series, though. But there's this one episode where they have this little chip, and it's called the grain, and it's implanted in, essentially connected to your brain and connected to your vision. So every single thing that you see, you can record, and then with the grain, you can show other people by projecting that image onto like a television. So it's almost like you have Apple TV connected to your head.
Whoa. That's probably just the future.
Not too far.
Yeah, no, exactly. That's exactly what it is. It's like
that's part of. I like to follow some futurists, and Ray Kurzweil. That's part of one of his things, is that we're going to have robotic technology in our bodies helping us out. And I mean, when they released Google Glass, I was like, oh, that's the prediction. That's coming true. We're going to become technology or merge with technology. Right, isn't that what the singularity is all about?
Yeah, like the transhumanism.
Yeah, so
transhumanism ideologies.
I like it that sci-fi is using that.
Yeah,
and then I wonder, right, how far away is that? Is that just a prediction, and we will be recording this stuff?
And our
brains are going to store it just like a hard drive.
Mm-hmm. There's certain companies that are 3D printing human tissue, so that we'll be able to replace our joints. Yeah,
and internal organs.
And internal organs, yeah, from our own tissue.
That's incredible to think about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know. That's just wild. I have no concept theoretically for any of that, but it's just an interesting thing to think of. How
there's all kinds
God.
Of things that are becoming available for the wealthy, the super wealthy.
Well,
know that for sure. Be an aspect, but even right now, I bet there's certain procedures and treatments and.
People who are diabetic can get these little patches that monitor for them.
Take care of yourself, honey.
Well, that's true. I know, because I want to live a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know about you. I'm going to take care of you because you're a little older than me. Mm. And I need you to stick around.
Mm. more of the green juices, man.
Yeah.
I'm not doing too bad.
That was delicious.
Yeah. But
that's only because I've been getting sick. You know?
Oh, yeah.
That's not practicing prevention, honey. You're supposed to do things ahead of time.
Maybe you're getting sick because you're not drinking enough of the green juices.
Yeah. Can't just get the juice once you feel bad. When you feel bad, it's already too late.
But I did want to talk about your so you have these, like, I'm assuming they're older works, but it's essentially like an archaeological study. Do you know the ones I'm talking about?
Yeah, well, I know the period. I'm not sure exactly which one in particular, but in the period.
You have this series where it's like there's cavemen, and they're like, they're raping and pillaging each other.
Oh, is it kind of like a...
Those are probably details from one large painting.
Oh, no, I think he's talking about
is there a
rape
series?
Of the Neanderthals. Is that
I think so, yeah.
Is that a series?
No, it was... It fell within a certain body of work. I did a few, actually. There's a period of years when it was all all my paintings were based on science in one way or another, one type of science or another. And that was, as you say, you know, archaeology and evolution was a subject for that. But it was just a, you know, kind of a childishly rendered image of
yeah, but I like
a bunch
that.
of Homo sapiens, modern humans raping some Neanderthals.
How did you explain it so at it the Phoenix Art like, Museum?
Similar to Rape of the Sabine Women, but it's Rape of the, of the Neanderthals, and so they're just they're pillaging and they're raping right. modern day. Because that's what your ancestors were doing about 20,000, 30,000 years ago in Europe.
Because you're a hack you're from anthropologist.
Your people come from Europe.
Right. You're a hack anthropologist and but archaeologist and botanist. He gave this talk at the Phoenix Art Museum a few years ago, and he explained this hack approach. Like, well, it's a science, and you're interested in it, and you always want to have all the answers or have all the background knowledge of that science, but you can't. Because that's not what you studied, but maybe you'll have come up with your own explanation anyway.
Well yeah. So it's yeah, it's almost like you're pretending to be, in that case, you know, an anthropologist or something. But it's more about playing creatively within the field. So you just, you know, you don't have to know everything. You just make it up, you know. So it's this hack approach to, you know, whatever, biology, to anthropology, to you know, geology and so forth. Yeah. So I just pick a subject and then, so some of it would be accurate, you know, the information. I mean, I do a little bit of reading or, you know, I've always
enough
been interested
so
that it's
in that passable. Stuff.
So enough that it would be, you know, I think the viewer would question, you know, in some of them, you know, more than others, but, you know, the accuracy of what they're looking at. But then upon further inspection, it becomes clear that this is, you know, clearly just making things up, you know.
I think that's what's funny about it.
Like, he has another giant painting of the moon, and then it's got, it's not even round, perfectly round. Like, if you look at the painting, you're like, it's whack. But he's got different landmarks on the moon that are sort of, you know, named, or some of them look like craters, and some of them just look dumb, like a zit on your face, and you're like, that's, there's no way that's what it really looks like.
Yeah,
but it could look like that. How do I know? I've never really looked at the moon, not even through a telescope. So yeah.
it's like who was there's, the guy just died recently, Horner, Paul Horner.
Oh,
he was, I don't know if you heard about that. He was one
fake
of these
news
guys.
Guy?
Yeah.
He yeah.
Creating
yeah.
these fake news articles, but it wasn't really to influence the election. He was more just
satirizing.
Kind of a
yeah.
Satirist, trickster kind
but
of a guy.
But people were thinking
it but
was
But it was
real.
The same. Yeah, I really understood his approach because he'd make these articles, you know, that were seemingly legitimate on the face, but you know, anybody with a modicum of knowledge or understanding of the issues would quickly realize, you know, it's a joke, you know, the whole thing is a joke. But he did get in some trouble because people, not everybody realized these were jokes, and they got passed around the internet.
Yeah.
And a lot of people think it affected the election. You know, this guy from yeah. Phoenix, Arizona, who was, you know,
making a, it's like the Onion, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But not That's everybody, got, maybe not everybody
more,
got the joke.
A little more harder to get the joke.
Yeah.
It was a similar kind of thing, but, you know, obviously less consequential.
Your hack approach to being an expert in all of these things reminds me of the Museum of Jurassic Technology. Have you ever been there?
I love the Museum of Jurassic Technology.
I think there's
it's
a similar
utterly
premise.
Confusing.
Yep. What is going that? On? Okay, next. Maybe we can go today if it's open.
Yeah, you should go today. You should definitely go today. Because
I know
Culver
you'll
City.
Appreciate it. Yeah. I remember hearing a story on NPR years ago and then going to check it out because one of the parts in the story was like, oh, yeah, and then the upstairs is a Russian tea room. And I'm like, well, that's quirky. And so we go, and I really thought, well, I don't want to give it all away, but I didn't know what to expect. And it has the name museum. So, you know, you're expecting an institution
yeah.
where everything is very serious and face value, and what you see is, mm-hmm. you know. So that was kind of an interesting – you would appreciate it, hon.
Yeah. My business partner said that he's a painter as well. His name's Justin Hopkins. And he said that he read this book that was specifically about the Museum of Jurassic Technology. And at the end of the book, the guy was still confused. Didn't know
Good.
What it was about.
See, they were able to keep it going.
Yeah.
That's cool.
I'm not exactly, I forget what the name of the book is, but I'll have to ask him. But I think that's what good art is. You don't come to a conclusion and you just kind of...
You're still thinking about it.
Yeah.
Puzzling over it.
Yeah. I don't like looking at art or like viewing art when it's like seemingly one-dimensional where, you know, you're like, oh, okay, I know what this is about. I know how this person did this. And
I agree. I've never been able to really appreciate it if I can figure it out right away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that's with a lot of things in life. It's like even relationships or like if you figure someone out in the first like 30 minutes, you're like, okay, this is what it is, you know?
Good writing's like that too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. Unless you're what?
I was going to make a really bad joke.
Of course.
Make it.
Unless she's got big tits.
Oh my God. Yeah.
My people that's awesome. Come from West Virginia.
I think that's why we get along, because we can appreciate each other's humor.
Yeah.
Because that's what I was waiting for you to say.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I hope he says it. I hope he says it. No.
I hope I say what you're going to say.
Sorry. Too easy to figure out. Oh, unless...
That's what I wanted you to say.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, exactly. No, I just... No, I actually knew that you were going to say it, so that I waited for you to say what I was thinking.
Oh, man, so I get in trouble.
But it's funny that I say that after the fact that you actually said it.
He gets kicked off of Facebook for stuff like this. And then I'm the one who gets
in trouble. Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't tell a joke these days.
Yeah. But I think it's funny because, you know, you talk about that and there's all these like silly things about life. And I mean, I was even in a conversation the other day with one of my friends and we were talking about how I personally still feel like I'm really young, like a teenager or something, you know, certain things. But then there's other things. It's like, oh, I feel like I'm like 150 years old.
Yeah, you know? I know.
So it's, but I see that in your work. There's that interesting push and pull. It's like, there's a master painter that's done this, but then a five-year-old like slaps something on the top of it. And yeah. I think that's hilarious. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm glad to hear you noticing that. Because it's how I feel often in the work. Sometimes I'll, in certain works, I'll need to, I'm going to take a risk or something. You know, I did this realist painting and I want to take a risk with it. And I want to,
yeah.
I might be a little more calculated. I might actually get myself drunk. So I have the sort of, I don't care enough or I'm, you know, courageous enough or whatever to make certain marks on the painting, you know, that take a big risk with the painting.
Really? You paint while you're drinking?
Well, no, I'm just talking about, no, I can't paint when I'm drinking. No. That's kind of the point, yeah. You know, is you get,
it's garbage.
You get less inhibited you know, often in certain cases, I mean, this isn't a regular practice I'm describing, but, you know, I might sit there and decide for a period of days that I want to do something to a painting and take a risk with it or something like that. But I don't want it to be too controlled. So it's a way of just sort of inhibiting hijacking that, the kind of control that was necessary in that very adult way. Like,
I know what you mean.
To use your analogy there.
Do you do psychedelics at all?
I haven't in a long time. I mean, once in like the last literally years. Like 20 years, I think one time. But I did a lot when I was younger, you know, a teenager and then early 20s.
Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely an influence, but why do you ask?
Well, first of all, I think psychedelics and psychedelic studies have come up a lot. You know, the benefits of like taking and microdosing like on psilocybin all those things. You know, I think that's a very current topic. You know, you hear a lot about it on like Rogan's podcast and like MAPS and like, you know, Zach Leary.
Timothy Leary's son?
Yeah, Timothy Leary's son. Really?
Wow.
Yeah, he's like dedicated his life.
Yeah.
Anyways, you know, it's just like, it's a very current topic.
Yeah, the medical establishment is investigating using mushrooms. What was it to treat people with?
Depression. What I read.
Exactly, yeah. But, you know, and I think it's about taking these substances with intentions. So recently, a couple weeks ago, I did psilocybin mushrooms with intentions of like trying to excavate. And this is also what goes back to your archaeological like studies But essentially, like, to excavate my mind and figure out, like, you know, figure out certain things. But that's why I asked about the
psychedelic. That's interesting, because it can be deeply personal, right? You can just go very internal when you're in that mindset.
Yeah. Yeah, like an internal, external, but internal. And you go in and out of all those things because you realize, or I realize that everything's fine and we're just molecules that kind of just bounce around into each other. And
that's a nice way to think about it.
Yeah. Understanding that you're not in control of everything.
It's funny. I still think about doing mushrooms from time to time, and you know, asking somebody. But I never do it for some reason. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no. When I was younger, I had an intense interest in psychedelics. But you know, a number of bad experiences, I suppose. Not just particularly with psychedelics, but other drugs as well. Kind of, you know, sent me in the other direction, sort of away from drugs altogether.
I get it.
Mm-hmm. Even though I drink plenty now, too much probably, but
only we all at have the end biases. Of the day, yeah. You know,
I can't work with, you know, it's just no help. There's never anything other than coffee has never been anything other than a hindrance to my practice, you know. I mean, not in all ways, obviously. I mean, you have experiences, especially psychedelics, you know, because it's so visual.
And, yeah.
You know, Terrence McKenna, he wrote a lot about psychedelics. And
yeah, that's pretty much what he dedicated his life to, him and Timothy Leary.
That's who I was reading all those years. College? The heroic dose, he called it.
Oh.
You know, what's that dose?
A massive.
What's the dose?
I don't know. Just something a massive ridiculous. Amount.
Like he would 50, describe 50 gold. Hits of acid or God. Something.
Wouldn't that kill you?
Probably.
Scramble your brain.
Yeah, yeah.
It's scramble your brain name for it.
Permanently.
And then you go in a dark room and you just lie there by yourself.
Yeah. I did have a question about within those like archaeological, am I even calling it the right thing? The archaeological studies?
Well, there would be archaeology, but what would you call them? What did I call them? I don't think I ever really had a name. I just always think of them as the science paintings. It's not a great name, but sort of groups because it was, you know, any branch of science was, you know, might have interested me, and then I'd make a painting out of them. You know, about that interest and exploration, you know. But yeah, some of them were dealing with archaeology, anthropology, any number of different fields. Yeah.
Would you consider that more of an exploration of yourself? What brought you to wanting to do those paintings?
About me. Only in the sense that I often, at least in the past, regretted that I didn't do something in science or medicine. Yeah. You know, I even had this, I sometimes would think, not so much anymore, but that I might have been more fulfilled or happy if I had gone into a different field than art or painting. So it was, but it was just exercising an interest that I had in a topic. But see the sort of, it's almost a sad aspect of those paintings is that I, you know, was the sort of trying to play creatively in that field, but you're clearly not an expert, you know, that you don't really belong there. You know, I mean, anyone can have a lay person's interest in whatever subject, but you know, I mean, I don't think those paintings come off as sad, but for me, it was like I had this sort of sad, pathetic idea when I was young and naive that I would make it big as an artist in my whatever early 20s, and then I'd go back to school and study science, you know, become a physicist or something like that, you know, make enough money to afford to go, you know, to some
prestigious really that school. Was a thought that you had.
Yeah, but it's a stupid thought, right?
Well, I don't know.
Well, it was, no, I mean, I don't think I wasn't realistic about that being a possibility. But some people do that. I mean, they'll have, you know, they'll go back to school in their 20s and 30s and start a whole new career. I just thought I might shift away from being an artist at a certain point before it's too late, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You're stuck being one your whole life.
Do you feel that way now? Or do you feel like... I mean, I know there's like all these complicated emotions that we all go through. I mean, I think about that in terms of like decisions that we make in terms of dedicating my whole life to art and things like that, you know? So I think it's a, you know, it's a definitely a human perspective, you know, because art is not exactly the easiest career path to choose either.
Well, I don't think everybody can have everything, you know, I have these ridiculous, it's almost a utopian idea that you can have everything you set out for. I have this deep need, I guess you can call it, for just a creative outlet, you know, to have something to work on, as much as possible. And you know, it's a personal, a lot of people have this desire to just, you know, be working creatively on something all your own and, you know.
But in a way, it's a discipline.
Sure, it takes.
You have probably the most steady habit out of anybody I've ever observed. I'm not that way because I don't like to have habit. I like change. I thrive on change. But he gets up at like 4:30 or even 5 in the morning, and he has a routine, and he goes and gets his coffee, and then he comes back and he goes to work, and he's at his easel, or he's, you know, finding another image to start a painting every day. Every day he's working. And I don't think I know anybody with that kind of work ethic, just Colin. Or, I don't know, probably I know a lot of hard workers, but...
I see what you mean.
His is constant, and it's just the thing that drives him. And even when we do a little weekend trip like this, I know that he's constantly thinking about the work and, like, waiting, like, anxiously until he can get back to it. Like,
she's trying to tell you I'm a pain in the ass.
No. No, I'm just sharing. We went on our honeymoon, and we were away for almost a week, and it was sort of like the first few days he was fine, and then I almost felt him unraveling because we were on this boat. We took a cruise, and it was still very enjoyable, but in a way I was like, I could sense that Colin wanted to be working, and it was hard for him not to be working.
Yeah.
Whereas for me, I go on vacation. I love vacation. I'm glad to be away from work, you know.
But well, that's probably the checks and balances between you two as well.
One time we went camping and he brought an easel and he was able to sit out there and do some plein air painting. And
I take a camera with me. And
he's always got his camera. That helps, you know. He's always got his camera with him.
Sketchbook or whatever.
Mm-hmm. You're a hard worker. That's a compliment. But it probably helps if you really love what you're doing. It doesn't feel like work. I know that sounds kind of cliche, but I imagine that's true.
Well, there's also the, you know, how important the work you're doing is, a sense that it, you know, matters in the world or helps people in some way. And I think some artists try to do that with their work, whatever it is, make it about an important issue or, you know, a human rights issues or whatever. They find some fulfillment in, you know, in that regard.
But then doesn't...
But I don't really do that. So I don't have that kind of satisfaction in the work. Yeah. It always feels like...
Well, you have a different... It sounds like you have a different sort of satisfaction of the work.
Yeah. Yeah. It's different.
Does that frustrate
but,
you?
But I'm just comparing it to like other occupations, you know, where you get to help people, I guess, more directly, you know. Not that I can't do that. I could go volunteer at a soup kitchen or something like that.
What Jenna was saying, does that frustrate you?
Yeah, if you don't get acknowledged or you don't get tons of sales and it was a show that you felt good about and put a lot of work towards and...
I've never felt... I've never... Yeah, I mean, there's lots of different kinds of frustrations. I mean, there's been... Most of the shows I do, I mean, I'm thinking about the things I need to improve upon or what could have been better and so forth. But there have been times, certainly when I thought I was doing good work and you know, sales are usually disappointing, and yeah, it's hard. I mean, there's all sorts of difficult things about the career, you know. And well, then it's even like, you know, you, you end a body of work and it's so much work, and you come away from it and with very little to show for it, and you want to just get back to work, and it's just, you know, it's hard. You're frustrated, and you might not have much money, or and you might feel discouraged, you know, about starting anew or continuing to build, you know. I mean, these are very common experiences for artists, you know. You're, I guess in literal terms, you have to deal with not having much, again, in literal terms, value in your society, you know. You're not going to be likely to be paid very much for your work, or, you know, in many cases anyway, there's obviously exceptions, but.
Yeah. I mean, I think those are real struggles that most artists go through, unless you're working on like big commercial projects or something, you know, especially like fine artists that have some sort of personal thing to say. It's hard to find that. I mean, even Caravaggio would sell his, at points he would sell his paintings for like a piece of bread.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. You just, you know, and Caravaggio is probably known to be one of the most profound painters. I mean, arguably, you know, but people know him.
Yeah.
But, I mean, so I don't know if it takes away from your genius. I think it's just about, and what I like to call is like your unique genius, you know, but it's, unfortunately, that's just the reality. This is where we live, how we live, you know,
capitalism.
But you know,
I was listening to, among the few different podcasts I was listening to, I just started to listen to the one with Konevsky, and you're talking a little bit about, I think, originality at the beginning of that one.
Yeah.
An interesting perspective on that.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of seemed like a good way of looking at
what the challenge for an artist to be truly original. Is that what you mean?
I think he said, you know, you have to correct me if I'm getting this wrong, but if you question if your work's original enough, you know, it's like you're begging, you're saying that you're not original enough in that you lack
intrinsically?
Mm-hmm. Intrinsic originality to begin with, you know.
I remember him. That was actually a very formidable conversation for me as an artist. So just having that conversation, because it was about that, you know, the lack of, or the thought of lacking originality when intrinsically you actually are original, because you've gone through your own experiences in life. You are interested in certain things. And that formulation of like all of those elements makes you you, right? But then there's also, and I remember in that conversation too, he was also saying about how when things hit, you know, it's like when things are popular and they, like sometimes you're not creating work that is hitting at that particular moment, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's often, and which is okay. And it's okay.
Yeah. It's often a mysterious thing. Like you just, I mean,
yeah,
for me anyway.
Yeah.
Like I'll be surprised when certain things are popular or they're, or they sell, you know. It's often like, I'm often like completely wrong about that. If I have a show, mm-hmm. it's like, I think, well, this painting, there's no way it'll sell. These ones over here are much more likely to sell. And then the results are the exact opposite, you know?
Yeah.
So, I just always thought I was bad at that. And I hardly even, well, I still consider that, you know, I want work to make work that's marketable, but it's not the final decision. But then on the other hand, I'm not really particularly interested in
being commercial.
Being gratuitous. Well, the opposite of that. I'm not interested in being gratuitously provocative or, you know, grotesque or whatever, mm-hmm. you know. So I probably don't have, you know.
That's a hard process to follow as an artist. I'm just relating as a writer. Like, how can I continue to do the thing that I'm doing, but make myself stand out? And when I went to get my MFA, I think all the writers in my program were going through that to some degree, like trying to figure out, how can I do this thing that I love to do, and whether it be memoir or poetry or whatever their genre was. Mm-hmm. And then there were a few people from our class that got published, and one of the women I know that I graduated with, that's how she makes her living, is just writing books. Mm-hmm. And then there's the rest of us.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I don't know, personally, that's a frustration of mine. I'm like, well, what do I do? How do I stand out and be original but still do what I do? Because, I don't know, I think our generation thinks about that terrible term selling out. I don't think my students think that way. Sell out, like, get on YouTube, make a ton of money. And people our age are like, no, I have to maintain authenticity. I have to do this thing that I do. That's definitely me. But on the other hand, I'm sure you feel this, honey. There's so many painters out there. There's so many. So
yeah, and there.
How do you stand out?
And in the Bay Area, when I went to the San Francisco Art Institute, there was a kind of a particular disdain for the commercial aspects of the high art world, the New York art world, or there was also a kind of anti-intellectualism that was kind of prevalent in, at least in the painting community, it seemed, as well. But there would often be a sort of a disdain for artists who would go off to New York and try to make it in the art world.
Yeah.
That's probably gone away permanently. I haven't actually been out there in a long time. I don't go out there much anymore.
The Bay Area?
But I remember that sense. And I've noticed it elsewhere, you know, throughout my career. Hmm. People who even think artists shouldn't be selling art, you know, it's this thing that's...
Yeah, I know.
Should be free or given, you know, to the world.
Well, I mean, it's even like if you look at Charlie Kaufman, you know, he's not exactly. I mean, he's probably, arguably, again, one of the, you know, greatest screenwriters of our time, maybe. But
what has he done? I don't
being know. John Malkovich and Adaptation, right? Okay. And I like him a lot. I follow his work, but he's made some films that I'm like, what are you doing? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, yeah, no, I, yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying, like, arguably, but he is, I guess the reason why I bring him up is that he's, you know, he's known to be a great writer, but he doesn't get the benefits of it. And a lot of the times there's a lot of these artists that are really great artists, but don't get the benefits, yet these other mediocre artists, or seemingly mediocre in perspective, for some reason it hits home with a majority of people more. It's kind of like, you know, the Marvel films that are getting put out there, you know, a lot of people find these things enjoyable.
Yeah.
Does it mean it's really good art? No, maybe not. But that's a struggle that artists have to live in, I think.
Right.
Yeah. I think this is like a universal issue for artists, who at least have a lot of integrity and, and then there are some artists who it seems like they can straddle that line. I mean, they do work that's commercially successful, but they're also really great at what they do, you know?
Yeah.
They're very popular, but they're also, you know, if it's a painter, they're also a painter's painter, but, you know, other painters like their work so I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's about finding that audience, though, you know, finding the
audience.
Yeah, finding that audience, like people that do appreciate your work and that can actually purchase the work too. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. Because there is that.
That's a challenge too.
And there is that group that do appreciate your work and that will have the money to actually buy your work too. Yeah. But it's about finding that, you know.
Yeah,
and maybe it's just you selling to other artists,
people to work with. Yeah. I mean, good representation, good gallery is, for a lot of painters, is absolutely indispensable. You know, a lot of artists, I mean, unless you want to do all that work on your own. I mean,
I can't crack the code. I don't know how the art industry works.
Yeah, it's a whole other
that was kind of an interesting
moment. Set of skills. And
there was a kid at the, when he gave that talk at BYU, this kid asked like, oh, well, how do you make this a career? Like, how do you make a living and how do you sell your stuff? And he gave it was a pretty good explanation of, from his own personal experience. But then I got really concerned about that kid. And when we went out to dinner later with the faculty member from BYU who had invited Colin to give the talk, I brought that up. I was like, oh, I was worried about that kid. I think he's in it for the wrong reasons.
Okay, so wait, why
he's asking him this question about making money. And the faculty member was like, no, I think he was just asking a very realistic question about how do you live this life. And
that's
how Colin answered this.
So how did you answer it?
Do you remember what you said?
I don't really
I think
remember.
You were really honest with him and you kind of said, I'm still trying to figure that out. You know, how do you get the right representation? How do you find people that buy paintings?
I see all these weird advertisements for how to make it as an artist or how to sell your work. And you
there's
know,
no 12 step program. You don't just do, you know,
something like that.
There's not a checklist out there.
You know, I can't even bring myself to look at any of these things because my whole strategy career wise, the whole thing was just to make the best painting I can, you know, that's it. That's my whole career, you know, business. That's my whole business strategy is to make as good a work painting as I can, to become a really good painter, to make hopefully paintings that are so good that they have to be successful, you know, or I have to, you know, and people will want them and want to work and so forth. And so, you know, where I fail, you know, I feel like that's, I haven't done that, you know? I mean, it's an ongoing struggle and there's many aspects to it. I mean, it's obviously not just skill and, you know, it's a combination of the form and the concept and, you know, coming together in unique and timely ways, you know, and you're just constantly searching for these things. And, but I mean, I've done shows I had with good, you know, the gallery I work with now is good, but the show I did with them was, you know, as a show, as a
didn't
body of
meet
work,
your expectations.
It was shit, you know, it wasn't for a lack of effort, but it just didn't come together, you know, in a meaningful way. It was just a confused period for me. I've done a couple
this
shows
was like 2 years
them.
Ago.
The 2015
a couple solo
show, right?
shows with yeah. them and
yeah
and I swear it's like, you know, I sometimes think there's something about my personality, like when a good opportunity comes up, I blow it somehow, you know, like all work people will
it's
be
like
interested.
A performance anxiety or
self-defeating kind of
I don't know what it is, because I mean it but I think it might have just been timing, because I've done other shows that I felt were
yeah.
strong and cohesive and made a lot more sense. But then I'll go through periods, you know, where it's much more experimental and I'm throwing ideas and paint around in ways, you know, that make the results unpredictable. And
that can
and
be dangerous if you're thinking about things commercially.
And right. And yeah. so, and then the, you know, I mean, and then I come out of that, you know, often after producing a lot of, you know, perhaps some amount of, you know, failed work, with some clarity on what I want to do going forward. And then I, you know, I might enter into a more successful period in artistically, and you know, it's just, I don't know, might have been bad timing or something, because I feel like the work I've been doing in recent years I'm feeling really good about it. You know, it's like there were a number of years when it was just confusion for me, a lot of confusion in the studio about what I wanted to be doing. And now I'm, you know, still hard and there's still confusion, but I feel much more clear about what I'm doing and much more disciplined and focused on a certain way of working. But I don't have the, you know, gallery or institutional support, you know, so I'm having to sort of, like, yeah. I'm doing solo shows in Phoenix right now, independently. Well, with friends, you know, I have friends there, and, you know, my friend Hector has a nice warehouse space. It's kind of a gallery slash studio, just opens a couple times a year, yeah, yeah. typically. So I just did a show with him, and but there aren't, you know, Phoenix is it's not a major art center, you know, there aren't a whole lot of good galleries there or anything. So the career thing is not gonna, you know, some people do okay there, but yeah.
Well, I think it's yeah, I mean, it's complex. I mean, it's all these decisions that you make, and, you know, you can't really force people to buy your work,
right.
you know? So
you buy this fucking
buy it. Buy it. Just shove it down their throat.
We could maybe move to a bigger market. Like, we could move to LA, honey.
Oh, you should move to LA, first of all.
I want to really badly.
LA is amazing. LA, and honestly, there's some really special things going on in LA in terms of the art scene.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like your neighborhood. Man, we could move in, be your neighbor.
Yeah, this is great. During the week, there, I don't know who owns these peacocks, but there's peacocks. There's two or three peacocks that just roam around the neighborhood.
That's so cool.
It's super interesting, yeah. But
yeah, I'm ready to move to LA. We spent yesterday at the beach. We came back to the hotel. He's just been talking about how great his feet feel. Like the whole, everything about being by the ocean.
Yeah, nice.
I got to play in the waves. It wasn't even too cold. I could do that every day. I could do that at least once a week and I'd be very happy.
Yeah. I try to go out to the beach as much as possible just to meditate.
Do you surf or anything?
I don't. My roommate does, but, I don't, but I do other things. As
meditation.
Well
for, you were saying that. Yeah. Listen to those waves or something. About
it is a meditation. Yeah. You can be very meditative out over at the beach, I think. Yeah. But, do you have any advice for people that are listening to the podcast? The final question.
I don't know. I think there's too many artists now.
Yeah, I mean, don't like become an artist. Man.
I know. Well,
yeah, going to tech.
We've already gone over the fact that I can be quite childish.
Become a computer programmer.
Time. Yeah.
Aw.
But yeah, no, that's a weird thing. I don't know if it's my perception is off about that. Seems like there are.
Seems like all of our friends are. Oh, wait, we have.
When I was younger, it didn't seem like there were so many artists. It seemed like it was kind of a unique thing, but might have just been my perception.
Well, I think there's something interesting that's going on with the advent of social media, and art is painting specifically is becoming cool again.
So is it? That's good news for us.
I think that's good. But I think, no, it's because, you know, with Instagram, like an artist, a painter, for instance, can be, or a photographer can also become like a celebrity in a way, which is good and bad. But I think it's good if you're continuing to do your own artwork, your own type of art, and you're not letting that, you know, the clickbait to inundate you, essentially.
Right.
But I think it's a useful tool. But I think a repercussion of that is there's more artists now. So, which is good because then it'll keep painting, photography alive in certain ways, but it also detracts from certain things as well. So there's a give and take, I think.
On the other hand, Colin just told me.
I didn't mean to be too much of a negative.
No, you just told me the other day.
Don't become an artist.
Yeah, and I think you're just being funny.
There are certain select people that you follow very purposefully on Instagram. You just told me the other day that there's kind of this little community of painters and you guys all know each other.
Oh, yeah. I mean, not all of us, obviously. I mean, but yeah, that happens. I mean,
and maybe you don't know each other.
Painters tend to
face
know
to face,
who,
but you know who
the other painters are.
Which is interesting.
Yeah, well, you were on Death of a Coworker for a while, right?
Yeah, I kind of flaked out on those guys. I felt a little bad about it, but they're fine.
Yeah, I'm sure it's fine. I mean, Justin Hopp was part of that as well.
Oh, okay, cool. Justin Hopkins. That's where I recognize that name.
Yeah,
from.
Yeah. And he's that guy's my business partner.
Awesome.
Oh, is that right?
With No Wave, yeah.
Oh, cool.
I got to inform myself a little more about this No Wave.
Oh, yeah, it's all good.
It's a collective.
Yeah. It's an art collective and partially an art gallery, yeah. But Mostly an art collective, yeah.
See, that would be something be cool to have in Phoenix, I guess.
Phoenix so is rough. Selective.
I mean, it's a small. Yeah, see, that's the thing. I would be
feelings.
Too.
That's good, though. I mean, not the hurting people's feelings part, but being selective. Being selective is a good thing.
But, you know, there's kind of a brain drain in Phoenix. The best artists tend to go elsewhere.
That's true. So. They move away here or New York.
Yeah.
Or Europe.
Well, the great thing about being in Phoenix is I can have, we have our own home.
Yeah, and cost of living
a
little is
backyard and affordable. A garden.
Yeah.
And would never be able to afford that.
We could make it work. I'll find some high power academic job.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's, even like some really talented artists are on the outskirts, you know. I used to live kind of like more towards the beach, but it wouldn't really deter me from like coming into the city. I mean, I know it's different than living in Phoenix, but I don't know. I think, you know, all the technology, you can make it work somehow, you know.
This is a nice location.
Yeah, it is. You're really like Echo Park.
All kinds of things.
Yeah, there's a bunch of huge artist community. Like a lot of the people that, not a lot of people in the collective, but mostly in LA, but there's, you know, a lot, there's an ecosystem in Echo Park of creatives. So I think that's cathartic in a way. Hmm.
That's cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Where can people find you on social media?
Instagram, it's probably the best place. I just pop in there pretty regularly. So,
cool. At Colin Chillag, and it's Colin with one L, Chillag with two L's.
Cool. Don't worry. I'll put it at the end of the episode so people will know. But yeah, thanks for coming and having this conversation, man.
It's good to meet you.
Definitely. You too.